Hello viewers, I'm SB and welcome to Curious Expedition Arctic Expanse, a free DLC expansion for the Curious Expedition. Looks like they only added one new explorer, so that's where we're going to be starting. There were no patch notes, so I have no idea what to expect except for the fact that we know that there are Arctic expeditions from the title. So this guy gets to start with chocolate, climbing gear, a shotgun, which that's gotta be good, right? Like, starting with a shotgun is pretty powerful. It's possible that he doesn't have any red dice. We'll see how it works out. Snowshoes, which are the machete equivalent for snow, I'm assuming. And tickets, a trading item used at polar stations. Okay, this is something. I don't know. We're gonna have to find out about these. He starts with reduced movement cost in deep snow, a native animal handler, and two huskies. I have no idea if huskies are different from other dogs. I guess we'll find out. Okay, this is pretty different. Looks like we don't get to try an Arctic expedition just yet. I don't know. I think dry lands are generally better than jungles. I mean, the less heavy jungle we have to go through, the better, right? Alright, Brother Robert approached me this morning. He had boarded the ship and requested we escort him to a nearby native village once we had arrived at our destination. I just want to make clear, this dude got onto the ship and then started talking to us, like he owns the place. Alright, so we can see that there's some new information available. We can see the loyalty of our crew members in the tooltip now. And I know some of you are going to be new to the game entirely. This is a new series, so I will be explaining what we're doing here a lot. But if this video is interesting to you at all and you have not seen stuff about this game, please go check it out. We have a playlist right here on this channel that has a ton of gameplay. This game is super good. And also I think the series is pretty compelling. A lot of very interesting stuff happened. I don't know if it was good necessarily, but interesting at least. Alright, so we're taking some water with us because even though we didn't go to a desert region, sometimes you encounter desert areas inside normal regions. Alright. So we have this sanity bar at the top of the screen here. Any kind of travel costs sanity. We don't have to worry about like food or drink as far as like staying alive, but any kind of travel costs sanity, and if your sanity bar runs out, that's really bad news. So there's a tremendous amount of the cost of movement is just like a base getting going cost. You can see down at the bottom there it says travel cost 28, and then in parentheses 15 plus 13. It costs 15 sanity just to start moving on this difficulty. It's lower on other difficulties. So you want to try to move as far as you can with each move. Lots of short moves will burn your sanity very quickly. But we are going to make a short move right here, up onto this hilltop, because elevation gives extra vision. And this will allow us to plan out our movement a little bit better. Okay, there's a cave down there that we might want to visit. Although, probably if we do that, we're going to do it on our way back to the ship. Let's go to the village. This, I presumably, is where Brother Robert wants to be taken to. I think we're going to approach the village from the south, just to avoid walking through the jungle. You can see jungle spaces are fairly high cost. It would cost us 25 sanity to move here, but 33 to take one extra step into the jungle. Whereas walking across the flat terrain is a lot more forgiving. All right, let's see what the natives think of us here. Okay, they've offered us some meat just for showing up. That's awfully nice of them. We're going to deliver this missionary. We accompanied the missionary to the village chief, who wanted to reward us with information about the preeminent landmarks to look upon in this vicinity, including a holy shrine, which he marked on our map. All right, cool. And we got some standing for that. In every region, you're going to have standing with the natives, the people who live in the region. And your standing governs how, first of all, how they're going to react to you when you encounter them in neutral encounters, or in random encounters, but it also governs how they're going to treat you while you're in the village. If your standing is 2 or higher, you can recruit natives to come with you on your quest. So we could pick up a shaman or a water buffalo. To be perfectly honest, I kinda like water buffalo a lot. And my thinking here is, if you look at our dice, I guess we gotta talk about all this stuff, didn't we? Every character in your party has dice. Red dice, green dice, blue dice, and the dogs probably have brown, yeah. The dogs have some unique dice that I've never seen before. But basically, these dice are used to resolve various types of conflicts. You'll have an encounter with somebody where you have to, like, the natives are angry at you and they want to fight you, and you can try to talk them out of it by rolling blue dice and trying to get a mind to show up. So the dice govern what we can do in various situations. Whenever you recruit a native and then try to get them to come with you back to England after the expedition, you have to roll your blue dice and look for a mind to convince them. And since we only have access to one blue die, I'm a little bit reticent to even bring a native with us, because I think we'll be unlikely to keep them. The water buffalo has no such qualms about staying with the party. In addition, the water buffalo has a lot more carrying capacity, and the water buffalo's carrying capacity is further extended by the native animal handler. This is what native animal handlers do. Also, all native crew members give you plus standing, so that's nice. I don't think this used to be visible. They always had it, but I don't think it told you on the tooltip, so I appreciate that's visible now. All right, let's trade with them. What do they have? Okay, they have jewels and teeth. This symbol here indicates that this thing is worth fame. Fame is our score. The goal of the game is to have a score above a certain level after the sixth expedition. So we have to make sure that we get stuff that is worth fame. And we could trade off of them additionally some coca leaves, which will give us sanity but may have some other effects. Apparently the villagers can give you water now, which I appreciate. The water has some value. I'm assuming my water is still valueless. Yeah. I can't bribe them with water. We get some ropes from them. Ropes are helpful in crossing swampy territories and also for climbing temples. Certain kinds of temples require climbing gear. I'm going to get all of their horn flutes for reasons that I'll explain in a minute as we're traveling. And I'm going to take their red mushroom as well. The red mushroom, it says here, has very potent healing abilities. The red mushroom will allow you to heal wounds if you take damage in combat or by falling off of something or something like that. It's better to use proper medical supplies, you know, bandages and stuff. The red mushroom can sometimes have psychotropic effects, but we don't have any medical supplies at all, so I think it'd be crazy not to take this one. Let's trade... It's probably not supposed to say plus infinity percent. That might be a small tooltip bug. You can see every item has a value, and then different items are worth different amounts to different people. So our shotgun is pretty valuable in general, but it has a minus 88% value to these people who do not understand the beauty and value of a shotgun. This has zero value, so we don't actually have all that much to trade them. We can give them some of our climbing gear. We could trade back some of the meat that they just gave us, but I think I'd like to keep that, actually. We'll trade them some of our climbing gear, which is not that valuable. Climbing gear can be used to climb temples and also makes it cost less sanity to cross hills. It's fine. I think it's way more valuable as trade, though, because it's a little overvalued. Alright, we'll take some coca leaves just to even this out. Now, we could do something like this, give them a trade that's very favorable to them, and we'd gain standing by doing that, but I don't think I want to do that right now. I think we need supplies too badly. Alright, and then we can rest in the village to regain some sanity, but doing so will cost us standing, so we overstay our welcome. Alright, as darkness fell, the natives lit a campfire and invited us to sit with them. The people of the tribe were celebrating the maturation of one of the boys. He looked quite grown already. He had started to sing a guttural song. They tried to tease me into participating in the ritual to prove my worth. So if we were to take this participate option, we would roll all of our red dice and try to find the little man. And if we didn't roll any faces that have the little man on them, then something not good would happen, probably. We don't have any red dice, so we're just going to decline. It's probably going to, hurt our standing. They laughed at my cowardice and turned their backs to me. All right, well, we'll sleep. Okay. So we're at zero standing now. I'm actually going to rest one more time. We're going to go slightly negative. At zero standing, they should be fine with us staying here one more time. And in fact, they're offering some alcohol to us. We are going to refuse the alcohol. Drinking the alcohol would give us extra sanity, but it would also might have some adverse effects. I'm not drinking strange alcohol from the jungle. All right, they don't like it when you don't play along. And so now we're at -3 sanity. If we tried to stay here, or -3 standing, if we tried to stay here again, they probably would not let us, or they would demand payment or something. So we're just going to bail. We got ready and headed out as new adventures could be waiting over the next ridge. The natives stared at me distrustfully as I departed their village. The subsequent day, I had the uncomfortable feeling of being watched. Yeah, we abused their hospitality just a little bit. I feel followed for 56 days. Interesting. I don't 100% know what that means. Alright, so we're going to travel as far as we can. Again, just trying to maximize our sanity per movement. Okay, well, we have a very limited sight lines here because of the jungle. So we're going to use this last climbing gear to get up on this hill. Okay. Well, that's enough information to make some decisions, certainly. Alright, so notice, we're getting pretty low on sanity. If we move past our sanity limit... Oh, this actually works a little differently than it used to. Interesting. If we move past our sanity limit, we'll start to have a risk of going insane, it looks like. And it looks like it's just plus 20% per space traveled. That's very interesting. Alright, well, we have all this food. We don't have to worry about it. So the villagers gave us some cooked animal meat. We'll just eat all of that. That was very helpful. Unfortunately, the goal of every expedition is to uncover a hidden golden pyramid in the region. And I'm thinking this could be it. No, wait, this is the shrine, isn't it? They told us where a shrine was and then it revealed this. So the golden pyramid that we're looking for could be any of these question marks, these points of interest. But if I had to guess, I think it's up here. And the reason I think it's up here is that it tends to be... first of all, it tends not to be adjacent to water, but it also tends to be in an area that's sort of geographically homogeneous. Usually it's surrounded by a lot of tiles of the same type. And that would be, like this, I could see this being the temple, because it's in a forest tile surrounded by forest tiles. Or the pyramid. But because we know this is a shrine, we know it can't be the pyramid, obviously. We are going to go here, though. Shrines are good. Shrines almost always have... shrines always have fame items in them, but they also often have other cool stuff. It looks like they updated the animation for the walk cycle a little bit. I don't think you used to throw off this much debris before. Okay, so every time you uncover a question mark, you gain some exploration points. And when you get enough exploration points, you can level up the human characters in your employ. You can't level up dogs and stuff. But, like, our animal handler could be leveled, and I think we will go ahead and do that. And we just gained some inventory space, because leveling up a character increases their, whatever their unique thing is. It also may improve their dice, and it always gives them health, too. I don't think we were supposed to gain this much capacity. I'm pretty surprised by that. That might be a little buggy. So, we're gonna mount up. I should have been mounted on the water buffalo the whole time. Being mounted allows you to pay a little bit less for travel. You can see the initial cost on movement has dropped to 11 instead of 15. And it allows you to use the animal in combat. So there's some hyenas up here that we might end up fighting. Let's have a look at the shrine, though. A large building loomed in front of us. It was a bold testament to the power of its creators. Low-hanging vines partially concealed the entrance that led within. The structure showed some long cracks, but it seemed safe enough to explore. So these shrines are cursed. When you take the stuff out of them, usually something horrible will happen, and the description here gives you a hint. The structure showed some long cracks, I think tells us that when we take the items out of it, there will be some territorial upheaval, a bunch of mountains will spawn. But keep in mind, new expansion, new rules. All of the information I have from before may be invalid now, so we're going to find some things out, that's for sure. Alright, you always lose standing for robbing the natives' holy places. And the moment we obtained the treasure, the earth began to quake. We hurried outside as the shrine collapsed, and huge mountains erupted from the ground. Uh-oh. and the group of native warriors appeared, seemingly out of nowhere. They must have been following me since I left their village. Their leader was clearly beside himself about my actions and demanded that I pay tribute as compensation. We're going to try to talk our way out of this with our blue dye. We failed. We steeled ourselves against the intimidating native warriors, but clearly they had not been bluffing and readied their weapons. All right, that's fine. We'll fight. So, when you fight, you roll all of the dice for everybody in your party, and the different faces do different things. It works a little bit like Yahtzee, or like Yacht, rather, where you can hold some dice and re-roll other dice. So this die, our water buffalo, rolled horns, which allows him to deal 4 damage to an enemy. What do we have? We have 3 native warriors. Okay, yeah. Give him the horns. You know what they always say, you mess with the water buffalo. I'm pretty unhappy with the rest of these faces, so let's re-roll these dice. We're keeping these, despite the fact that they don't do anything on their own, because of this. So some dice can combo together certain faces. This Ripper Leap does 4 damage and leaves the enemy bleeding, which makes them take 2 damage at the beginning of their turn. A couple of, I think, 3 turns for the next 3 turns. So we're going to throw the Ripper Leap on this dude. I didn't want to do it on this guy because I'm trying to be efficient with my damage. So this guy will take 2 damage at the beginning of his turn, and we're going to throw 2 damage from one of the dogs on top of that. So at the beginning of his turn, he'll die. We don't have to worry about him anymore. We rolled the gun on our shotgun die. That's what this shotgun is doing. It gives us the extra die. So we'll shoot him, and then we'll finish him off with the other dog die. And what is this? Taunt. Oh, that's interesting. So this dog will taunt. Alright, at the beginning of their turn, this dude bleeds out, and then that guy, unfortunately, did not roll a functional combo. The spear die doesn't do anything by itself. He needs to roll spear plus sword. Sword is like the attack action. So if this system seems a little strange to you right now, just trust me. You will get it quickly. Alright, so we're looking for that Ripper Leap again, or doesn't matter, Water Buffalo saves the day. Most animals are pretty good fighters. Alright, we got their spear. The spear is a consumable. When you use it in combat, it is you lose it. But it's pretty powerful. We got a mango from them, so that's a good 10 sanity. Mangoes spoil quickly, so we don't want to try to carry it around. We want to just use it right away. My suspicion is that the pyramid that we're looking for is up here. So we're going to eat all of our chocolate. Our animal handler had some things to say about that, but we don't speak her language, so unfortunately we have no idea what they were. This is going to get hairy. This is going to get ugly. Alright, I think it's like right here. Yep, it's right there. So, as we draw up on it, we see it, and then we explore it. Pluck will do it every time. We enter the pyramid and gain 30 sanity. Make no mistake, though, getting back to the ship will be dangerous. So now, we still have to get back. Obviously, it's quite a distance. We have to travel the same path out that we used to get in because there's mountains blocking everything all over the place. And also, we're going to have to fight these hyenas. We could run from the hyenas. There's no reason to. Hyenas are not particularly adept fighters. Alright, so we're going to keep these, trying to roll Ripper Leap again. I'm going to re-roll the water buffalo's die. This face does 2 damage, the hoof. We're hoping for horns or that other, the fourth face there, Ram, does 3 damage. So he's got a lot of faces that are more effective than the one we rolled there. Okay, we found our Ripper Leap. Ripper Leap is good enough to take out one hyena. He'll bleed out at the beginning of the turn. And then we can combine the damage from all of these dice to deal with the other guy. Okay, we'll take all the stuff. The natives don't like it when you kill the wildlife. And at this point, basically, we've desecrated their homeland to such a degree that we are now kill on sight. I'm not, like, overjoyed about it. Alright, we've made this campsite inaccessible by causing a bunch of mountains to spring up everywhere. There's no path anymore. If we had dynamite, we could blow up some of the mountains. You may be surprised to hear, the natives don't care for that either. Basically, they're very, They're very sensitive about the wholesale destruction of their homeland and the theft of their ancestors' belongings. And, you know, they're a real bunch of babies, really. All right, well, we don't have any food left. We don't have any way to gain sanity. We got to get out of here. So I guess it's time to go a little bit insane. What am I going to do? Are we just going to run? I mean, I guess we just like run for the ship. There's not even really any reason for us to stop anywhere at this point. We could try to go... We could check this out. Usually, a question mark on a mountain is a cave, and you can't really safely explore a cave without some source of light. But this one, being surrounded by all these water tiles, might actually be a waterfall instead. Alright, let's see what happens. This system used to work a little bit differently. I'm not sure what's going to happen now. Alright, bad stuff. Some time ago, I conversed with Lysifikek, apparently is the name of our animal handler, about the British Empire and its abundance of pleasantries. I'm unsure if this was a good idea, since he seems to have become obsessed with the topic. So he gained some minor insanity effects. So it looks like, okay, after you have a bad insanity effect, you get a little bit of travel for free. And then you have, again, the slowly mounting risk of more insanity. I'm not happy about this. Kleptomania is bad. Oh no! I had already withdrawn myself when I was awoken by a loud gunshot. I immediately ran to aid Lysifikek against an attack, but to my horror I found him dead on the ground, killed through my own gun. A tragic accident? I cried all night. Well, that's less than ideal, so now we're overburdened. Being overburdened doesn't actually have a tremendous effect if your sanity's at zero. The primary thing that being overburdened does is make it cost more sanity to travel. So, we'll throw away the water. Okay, this is a waterfall. So a waterfall is a nice, pleasant place where you can rest overnight. And doing so will get us some of our sanity back. Unfortunately, we're also having some hallucinations. I found a convenient camping pitch. One soul was staring back from the abyss. We barely managed to collect enough wood to light a campfire. He was rising in the depths. I knew. I was a pawn. A prawn. But he... It would exalt me. I just had to find it. The markers. I had to touch the markers. I've never seen this before. This is new text from the expansion. I wonder if this is actually referring to a game mechanic, or if this is just general, you know, insanity. Very clearly this is like a reference to the Cthulhu mythos a little bit. Who knows? But we rest for a few days, we gain some sanity. Unfortunately, we're going to have to fight these villagers. We may as well attack them now, rather than waiting for them to come to us. So what do we got? Scout, warrior, scout. The combination of red and green die allows a couple of combos. Man plus hand is 3 damage. And then the shield allows them to generate defenses that negate some of our damage. Unfortunately, we don't get the effect of our water buffalo. When your pack animal is overburdened, you don't get the benefit of riding it, the combat benefit. So that's a shame. Alright, we'll go for strong claws. We'll have one of the dogs throw out a taunt. We no longer have enough dice to pull off the Ripper Leap combo, because our native animal handler was the second green die. So I'm not sure what the best thing to do with this is. Unfortunately, I think the best thing we can do is use the shield. I think shield plus mind is a combo that gives extra shielding. Alright, we'll do 4 claws worth of 4 damage here. Finish one of these guys off with the quick shot. Okay, that's pretty bad. So the eye doesn't do anything by itself, and we don't have any way to combo with it. But we can do this, so that'll negate the first point of damage we take on the next turn. Oof, spear attack. That hurt. That was a lot of damage. Well, hold on. Let's not apply our strong claws yet. My instinct is to use it on this guy, you know, most efficiency possible. But actually, we do need to kill the native scout, and if we end up, you know, through a terrible luck not rolling any other damage, we do want to make sure he goes down. I don't think I want to expend my spear yet. I think I want to hold on to that for now. Alright, so we can go shotgun on this guy. Now we can go ahead and apply the strong claws. And we got the other strong claws. Okay, the dogs are doing fantastic work so far. Ooh, green mushroom. Suffers from seeing locations that are not really there. Oh, that's new. That's clever. Fortunately, we saw the whole map before we went insane, so we know what it actually looks like. All right, well, we need to rest some more. It was a beautiful night, and everyone seemed to enjoy themselves. I gazed deep into the carved eyes of the face in the mountain. I felt like a speck of dust in an uncaring universe. Who had carved this awesome monstrosity? When? And what laid behind its unmoving grimace? Is there a mountain nearby that has a face on it? There's one over here. Alright, so the reason that we got such so much more pleasant of a rest that time is that there's actually, you can see there's little tick marks here. If your sanity is below this mark, then you're going to probably have bad events. If your sanity is above this mark, you're going to have mostly positive events, and in here it's pretty much neutral. I'm going to rest one more time. We're going to absolutely full sanity. There was no escaping these guys, no matter what we did, so. Alright. I'm going to dismount from the water buffalo, since it's not providing us any benefit anymore. Now we need to drop some items. So we can probably afford to, you can see, by the way, the feather here tells you that the item does not count as, it doesn't fill up a slot. So the tooth and the tickets are not taking up any space. We could drop the ropes. We don't really need two ropes, and two ropes is not enough to be, like, valuable. This meat doesn't really do anything for us. It'll be removed after the expedition. You can't, you know, sail a bunch of meat back to London and have it still be usable. And we can't do anything with it. If we had somebody in our party who could cook, they can make edible food out of it, but the meat's not of any value to us right now. I'm going to go ahead and throw away the mango, because it will probably spoil before we have a chance to use it. Mangoes spoil very quickly. We need to make two more slots, so I'm going to eat this green mushroom. Ate the mushroom with great courage. He started muttering God knows what and crawling on the ground. Afterwards, he couldn't stop smiling. So that didn't really, Hey, stop talking so I can see your debuffs. Okay, that removed his hallucinations, so that's cool. Green mushrooms remove some of your negative mental effects. They don't heal you or anything. Then we have to drop one more thing. I guess it's going to be the coca leaf, even though the coca leaf does have some value to us still. It's less valuable than everything else we have. Alright, so if I move twice to here, they'll move twice to here. You want to initiate combat. You don't want to get attacked. Because if you get attacked, the enemy gets a free turn to hit you before you get to do anything. Alright, so this time they brought a shaman in addition to two scouts and a warrior. And the attacks are going to keep getting worse. So we're just going to reduce their number of dice as quickly as possible. Wait, which die is this? I don't actually know how to tell which dog the dice belong to, and in the pre-expansion it didn't matter, but here it totally matters, because I don't want this one to taunt. If it's his die, I'm fine with that. Hope can taunt. Alfonso should not taunt. Also, Alfonso is a great name for a dog. Alright, well, we're going to hold these. I'm not going to make any decisions until I see what all my dice look like. Alright, well, I guess we'll shotgun one of the scouts. We can't kill anybody, but we can get the scout pretty close. I could throw the spear, but I'm pretty sure the spear doesn't combo with any of the faces we have here. It does combo with shield, if we had rolled shield on our green die. Alright, I'm gonna hit taunt. Okay, it was the... They ought to add a way of telling who dice belong to. Oof. Well, Hope is, or Alfonso. Alfonso's not doing so well. That's, There we go. Tactical advantage, 3 shield. They generated 5 shield on their turn, so it's almost not even worth attacking them. Oh no, actually, we get through a little bit. We'll do 1 damage to this guy in total. Alright, I think we may have to use our shield, or our spear to get out of this. So, 4 damage, 2 defense, and then we can finish this guy off, and now their potential for generating shield is significantly lower. Alright, we should be able to win this from here. We're definitely a lot more injured than I would like to be, though. Wow, every one of those is not what I want. Here we go, this is a little better. Okay, so we can finish this guy off. I'm not going to play the taunt, because I would actually really like it if he didn't hit the dog here. Alright, we got those strong claws. It should be pretty straightforward from here. I shouldn't have rerolled the shotgun. I clicked the button too quickly. That was dangerous. Luckily, we were not punished. Oof. Okay, well, that's both of the dogs then. Wow, what a bad sequence of rolls that was. So now it's just my die. Just my dice against his. Alright. Jeez. Okay, the dogs remarkably are not dead. So let's heal them up. Hope ate the mushroom with great delight. She proceeded to dribble and stare at my groin. Afterwards, she was miraculously healed. We're going to give another one to Alfonso. Okay. So, you're, being at 0 health isn't the end of the world, obviously, but if you travel with a wound, you can get an infection, and that can actually kill you. Unfortunately, I am super injured. I didn't take the mushrooms because I'm a little bit more concerned about the dogs not being available for combat. When you have 0 health, you don't contribute your dice to combat, as you saw there. I'm going to drop something. I think it's going to be the green mushroom. As you can see, our travel is a lot less sanity taxing when we're not overburdened. I kind of want to go to this cave. We have a torch now, so we can explore a cave. I kind of want to take advantage of this, but maybe we need to just get to the ship as quickly as possible on account of my festering wound and everything. But I love treasure. Now, let's just head to the boat. We'll take the torch with us, we'll explore something next on the next expedition. So like I said, we don't want to get attacked. We want to do the attacking. If they move adjacent to us, they get to start it. So I'm going to try to go... When we move, they will also move. We don't want them to get adjacent. So if we were to move like directly in the path that we're trying to go, toward the ship, we move here, they move here, they attack us. So we're going to move like this... And as long as they're within 2 spaces of us, we can initiate the attack. Alright, we better hope this goes better than the last one did. They are bringing more people every time. As you can tell, this is going to be the last the last battle that we have even the slightest chance of winning. So we have 6 damage represented from our dog's claws right now. I'm going to go ahead and kill one of these guys. We have to make sure they don't generate these huge amounts of defense. That really was killing us last time. If we roll shield, I will definitely use the spear. We did not roll shield. Like I said, yeah, the spear doesn't combo with any of the dice we have here. Alright. So we still get to roll the spear next round. Okay, this is bad. Okay, I think we're dead. I think we just died. Yep, if everybody in the party goes to 0 HP, all of the human members of the party go to 0 HP, then you die in combat. Not super great, that one. You know what, we got time, let's start it up again. So on the different difficulties, the game does function a little differently. In addition to the higher cost of movement on Certain Death, Certain Death is the only difficulty where you have to find your way back from the pyramid. on expedition and tourist trip. When you find the pyramid, that's a successful end of the expedition. So the game is really a lot easier on the lower difficulties, but we've played enough of it. We should be able to do this. So we're going to try this one more time. A trader approached me with a request. He needed a message to be delivered to the chief of a village located in the region we were headed to. Okay, we can do that. I can deliver a letter. That'll give us a little bit of standing with the tribe in the region. We're going to take some water with us, just like last time. Okay, and it would be really great if we didn't run out of sanity really early. So let's, we can't see, like, anything. We have very abbreviated lines of sight here. And we have to travel through heavy jungle, which is the worst, up to a hill to be able to see anything. So we're losing almost all of our sanity immediately. But now that we have all this hill vision, we can actually make some choices. We definitely want to get to the village as quickly as possible. We have to be a little bit more careful, it seems like, not to abuse the hospitality of the villagers than we had to be before. This group were a clan of well-trained warriors. The villagers observed us with curiosity as our trek arrived at their settlement. We were able to walk amidst their number freely, as though there was nothing unusual about our arrival. Alright, we're going to give them the letter. To reward us, the chief regaled us with stories of the greatest wonders to look upon in the vicinity, including a holy shrine which he marked on our map. So it seems like standing is more important than it used to be. Alright, we're at 2 standing or higher, so let's go ahead and do a little recruiting here. For some reason that gave us exploration points. Maybe that does that now. So, who's interested in coming with us? Tupac the warrior or a water buffalo? Okay. I don't think there's any good reason to take a donkey over a water buffalo. Donkeys basically are just, they're just a little bit worse, in my opinion. A warrior is interesting. First of all, having another native member of the party would give us +1 standing at the beginning of each expedition. He has stealth, which reduces, what it means when it says this reduces the chance that animals that you pass will want to attack you. That can be useful sometimes. A lot of the time, you want to fight animals, but... And he has a red die. The red die is especially notable here because the shotgun die has a combo with red dice. So I think we're actually going to take the warrior. In most situations, I would want to take the pack animal, but... Alright, now let's trade with them. So we have a lot of... Wow, they have some cool stuff. We have some concerns here. We really need to recover our sanity. We already wasted a ton of sanity. But we have to do it without damaging our standing too much, because the villagers get... they follow you now. They actually, like, hunt you. So an elephant tusk has 30 value, but these guys only value it at 15. They don't understand how much this will be worth back in London. In addition to the fame, denoted by the thing here, 20, it also has a funds value of 60. When you bring something back to London, you can trade it for fame, which is, you know, victory points, or you can trade it for funding to buy gear for further expeditions. Elephant tusks are a great source of funding. In addition, I would very much like these jewels for the same reason, just good source of funding. And we want this drum. Drums are amazing. So we're going to trade all of our climbing gear to them, eagerly. We're excited to trade off this climbing gear. And a chocolate ration, and we'll take a horn flute. The reason we wanted the horn flute last time, and I didn't end up talking about it because we didn't make it back to London, is that there is every time you... For each expedition, you'll be offered a quest, and one of the quests asks you to gather a bunch of native music instruments. So if you build up a stockpile of, you know, flutes and drums and stuff before receiving that quest, then when you complete it, you'll obviously have more stuff to turn in, and the guy who wants the instruments pays you very handsomely. Now, I know this may seem crazy based on what I said in the past, but I don't think we're going to trade for the red mushroom, because I think we just don't have enough stuff to give them. Unfortunately, we're not going to be able to avoid annoying them a little bit, because we really need to stay here, like, twice at least. Alright, as darkness fell, the natives lit a campfire and invited us to sit with them. Alright, as much as I'm a little skittish about this, but we're actually going to go ahead and take the drink. And man, alcoholism. Anytime you take alcohol, your party members have a chance of gaining the alcoholic trait, and the alcoholic trait is probably the worst trait for a party member to have. Maybe not the worst, but very close to the worst. Pyromania is not great either. But we did get some free sanity out of it, at least. It tasted bitter, but we stayed up long into the night, drinking and laughing with the villagers. Tupac had too much of the beverage before he fell over and slept with a smile on his face. So we gained a little bit of standing there, which will help offset the standing loss from sleeping here. I slept in great comfort and safety. The next morning, when I was awoken by a group of native children, surely poking fun at the strange foreign fellow. I read a word that wasn't in there, but you guys can see it. An elderly man gazed intently at my drums and asked if he could have a look at them. Oh boy. Okay. If we refuse, we'll take a significant standing penalty. If we allow him, there's a chance he will break our drums. But I'm going to take it. I'm going to take the chance. Allow. Oh! He played a few notes, then tightened the skin, stretched over the top of the instrument a fraction, improving its sound noticeably. Fantastic. So, when you do that, there's a chance that he can break your drums, but there's also a chance that he can tune the drums and make them even more effective. More effective at what, you ask? Well, it turns out you can play the drums to gain sanity. You also get increased aggro chance. It makes it more likely that hostile animals will follow you and attack you. But that's fine. We can fight animals. I'm not afraid of them. So, let's get moving. That really worked out very well for us. Tuned drums are very helpful. So the 10 on here indicates a 10-day cooldown. So we'll be able to gain 15 sanity basically almost every time we stop moving. So let's move to this hill for some vision. Hell yeah. So the horn flutes, unfortunately, do not allow you to gain sanity. Horn flutes distract animals, so you can use them to confuse animals and make them stop chasing you. Where do we want to go? Where do I think the pyramid is? It's really hard to say. It's definitely north of this temple, but I don't know where exactly. Let's do this. We'll go to the temple, we'll steal whatever's in there. I know the villagers in the region won't like it, but to that I say, hearty, whatever. God, look at how good drums are. Okay, a large building loomed in front of us. Its stone walls were covered with ornate engravings. Low-hanging vines partially concealed the entrance that led within. I could swear I heard the sound of rushing water under our very feet. So if we, I'll show you, because we're taking this stuff. We grabbed what we could and hurried outside as enormous fountains of water burst through the ground and began to flood the surrounding area. We had to run like our lives depended upon it, or drown in the grand lake forming around us. It's true, we do have to run. I'm going to go ahead and eat all of our chocolate so that we are no longer overburdened. And we're going to move to this hilltop because we need some vision. And as you can see, the ground beneath us is in fact going to open up, and we're about to have a real bad time. So we move to here. No, okay, good. No insanity effect. I wish the tiger hadn't moved away. I'd like to fight it, but we don't have time to track it. So we're going to enter the pyramid and gain 30 sanity. And then we're going to lose all of our sanity, like, immediately. And here comes the madness. You know, these things happen. We're definitely going to check out what this is, though. So we need to make sure that we're moving in a way that prevents the water from affecting us. Now, the game will try to, when you do something like this, the game will try to path you in the way that costs the least sanity. But that's not always your primary concern. So it's important to check your pathing. Here, the sanity value of the spaces doesn't matter very much. No matter what we do, we're going to be insane by the second space. Or at least we're going to be at zero sanity, risking being insane by the second space. So we may as well path over this hill. It doesn't actually add any distance to go this way, instead of the way the game was telling us to go, but it does give us a little bit more vision. Not a ton more, sadly. Tupac brushed past me to the front. While walking a few steps behind him, I noticed him constantly scratching his neck, and I saw something that looked like a ghastly bite wound. I wondered how he could not have noticed getting it, and to just stop scratching. What an unseemly habit. By the way, you may have noticed that Dory casually mentioned that animals can't speak. That's good. We're having some sanity problems, and she's just trying to remind us. A sane person knows. Animals can't speak. Thank you very much, Dory. That's good advice. Well, we can play our drums. That doesn't even give us the ability to walk one space. Ugh. So, strange bite mark. I've never seen this before. This is new. Is he going to turn into a vampire on me? Is that what's happening? Oh, his loyalty was decreased. If we don't give him alcohol, he gets touchy. Anxiety spread amongst the group. We discovered that Kifahu had been so nervous that he dropped an item during the previous leg of our journey. Not just an item, quite a number of items. Bad luck, but he didn't drop anything that's actually valuable. I would have been upset if he had, like, lost our tusks or something. The water shouldn't follow us forever. It will stop eventually. I can't tell if it's still chasing us or not. It may have stopped here. I would love to stop at the stone overhang. The deal with the overhang is you can rest at it. Sanity restoration. But I don't think we can actually do it. I think we have to keep going because the water's going to sink it. This is not, this is not going that well. To be perfectly honest with you, apparently I'm bad at this game now. All right, so we're going to start running. We're going to have a negative effect any moment now here. Okay, Kifahu is still dropping stuff. Fortunately, it's mostly just tickets and snowshoes and water. All right, we're not going to use the drums. It seems like using the drums reset our sanity odds when we did it earlier. It's probably because we weren't at zero. So if we just keep running, we're less likely to suffer a lot of events. Now notice, like I said, the game tries to path the lowest sanity cost route. But because we're already at zero, what we want is the route that takes the fewest number of steps. So like this. Alright, we'll walk by this cave. We're not going to try to explore it, because we don't have any light, but we get the expiration points for revealing it. The journey was taking its toll on the animal companions. At night I heard an angry curse. Tupac had been bitten and was bleeding from an unsightly arm wound. He was urging me to take the appropriate measures against the animal responsible. It was obvious that Dory was the culprit as she was trying to hide behind a large rock. I could see panic in her eyes. We're not butchering Dory. I refuse. This upset Tupac beyond a civilized measure. He would need a while to accept my stance. Alright, so there's a pretty good chance that we're not going to be able to get Tupac to come with us. He kind of hates us now. That's okay, he carried loot. He did his job. So let's get back to the ship and get the hell out of here before we all die. Our triumph was beyond our wildest imaginings. I remembered the great many things we had left behind in these cursed lands. Our vessel set a course for Britain. I could not wait to get back home and talk about what we had found there. After all this hardship, extraordinary pride overcame me. I knew that my name, Roald Amundsen, would be forever remembered. I congratulated Tupac, but instead of excitement, I saw regret. He would never leave these sacred grounds. So we could roll our die and try to keep him on, but I think actually we're just going to let him go. He's an alcoholic, he kind of hates us. I suspect that there would be problems in the future, so let's just let him stay here. No regrets. Alright, so in addition to Golden Pyramid, the points, the fame points that we get for the Golden Pyramid, we also got a 50-point New World bonus. I'm not sure what this is. This is new. I wasn't paying too much attention to the geographical location of the pin we picked for the expedition, because it didn't matter before, but it's possible that we picked one. Did we pick one that was in the Americas? Maybe there's a bonus for doing that now. And we got a speed bonus. You might have seen along the left side of the screen, there was a bar indicating the progress of the other explorers we're competing against. Whoever gets their expedition done first gets 200 points. Second is 150, third is 100, and so on. So there is a benefit to getting the job done in the fewest number of days, in addition to, which is sort of in tension with, the benefit that you get from being thorough and finding all the treasures. And after every triumph, we get to choose a perk, so we can We can get reduced movement costs in shallow rivers. That's probably not gonna be the call. We're not gonna travel across shallow river spaces enough for this to matter. We can also get the same effect, but in deserts. This is a little bit more meaningful because you can intentionally pick expeditions that are mostly made up of desert terrain, but I think we're going to pass on both of those to pick up anthropology. You can make anthropological studies of indigenous cultures, so whenever we sleep at a village, we can study their culture and write a paper, and the papers are worth fame, quite a bit of fame. So I think anthropology is definitely the call. Picking anthropology early can get you a lot of extra points. Alright, so you can see here, as people returned home with these treasures, scoring these numbers of points. We were the first one back, and we got 360, and then we have this stuff. So for everything, like I said, we can gift it to the museum in order to score points, or we can sell it at auction to fund our further adventures. We are definitely selling both the tusks and the jewels. We're going to gift this to a museum because 70 fame is quite a lot. And then we're going to sell this necklace for funding because I would like to have... You want to have more than 100 funds for each expedition. Whew, okay, we made it through that. Still no chance to go to the Arctic. I'm a little disappointed. So we can see where everybody else is going. I don't know that this is necessarily valuable information, but we can see it. So we can go to the treacherous desert, and you can see at each location, you get a little bit of a preview in the little hexagons of the things you'll encounter there. So in this desert location, there's a village on the right there, a burial mound next to it, which will have a mummy inside of it. Mummies are very high fame value, but obviously the natives have a real problem with you carrying their ancestors around. And also sometimes the mummies aren't all the way dead, which can be an issue. So I think we're going to go to the Tiki-Taka jungle. The treacherous desert, the mummy thing is a higher fame value, but it's also going to be more difficult. Traveling across the desert can be tricky. Now, you know what? We need the points. Alright. After rising at the break of dawn, I arrived at the docks. We had a little time before the ship would be ready, so I had one last pot of tea. A military chap approached me and spoke of a deserter who had taken to hiding in a native village. I'd be suitably rewarded if I could return with the traitor. Yeah, I'll do that. We'll find your traitor. The soldier complimented our honor as I accepted his request. He saluted me and wished us luck before leaving the harbor. The news of my glorious adventures had spread, so I was not surprised to see that stories of my exploits had lured all manner of intrigued personalities. Many new recruits showed up, eager for adventure. Who would I recruit? So, we get to... Ooh, Mountain Trooper. Reduces movement costs when traversing hills. This is a new kind of guy. I've never seen these ones before. So we get to pull somebody for our crew. We could take a British soldier, who will gain us sanity when we fight stuff. Anything that gains you sanity is very valuable. And, like I said before, a red die combos well with our shotgun, so I think this is very likely to be the call. He also has a 2-crate carrying capacity, which I appreciate. We could get this artist instead. Artists allow you to make paintings of, like natives and beautiful landscapes that you encounter and stuff, which is cool. It's worth a lot of fame, but poor carrying capacity, a blue die that we don't really have a lot of use for, and I don't think we need the fame as much as we need the ability to survive. And then this mountain trooper lowers the cost of traversing hills and brings us a green die. I'm curious about this because each different class of follower has a bunch of different events that they contribute to and stuff. I'm curious to run with a mountain trooper, but we'll probably do that in a future expedition. Right now, I think we need this soldier. Also, it's worth noting, soldiers have a high starting loyalty, which is cool. Alright. Purchasing equipment. We definitely don't need snowshoes. We do need food. We don't have any food, so we're going to buy a lot of food. We also should have some medical supplies. It would be a good idea for us to have a little bit of medicine on hand. I'd like to bring a torch or two. We're likely to encounter caves. And then we're just gonna, food for the rest of it. There we go. Weather balloons can be very valuable. They help you locate new locations nearby, but we just don't have the funds. We need all of this food pretty badly. All right, deal. You can also purchase improvements for your pack animals that increase the number of spaces in your carrying capacity, but we don't have any pack animals, so we can't do that. All right, let's get out here. Let's try desperately not to die. One death per episode is enough. All right, I was curious to discover what adventures were waiting for us here. We're definitely going to want to make sure we bring water, because we know we will be encountering desert. All right, so we'll drop this little bit of extra water. Oh, you know what? Actually, let's access the storage on the ship and let's put our snowshoes in there. We're definitely not going to need them. So I feel pretty comfortable with this. 3 stacks of water should be enough, I would hope. So you can see here, it will use a stack of water each time we cross desert terrain to reduce the cost of the crossing. Also, I didn't actually spend my level up point, the exploration point that we earned earlier. I think we're probably going to be giving them to Sergeant Newton Teague, because we, again, don't have any pack animals to actually take advantage of here. Oh, I didn't notice. Dude is sexist. That's interesting. It probably won't have a big effect, but it's something to remember. So let's just travel to a hill. We're going to hold the level up point until we actually need it. Let's travel to this hill and have a look around. Okay, that's good information. So it looks like the adventure is mostly going to be this way. It's a lot of an awful lot of mountains blocking our way. Play our drum before we move again. And I don't really care about the enemy attention debuff. If we encounter an animal, we're likely to fight it, because fighting gives us sanity. So the debuff is pretty meaningless to us. Alright, a curious man-made rock statue. The grotesque face seemed to focus on us. It was a disconcerting sight, and I desired to move on. However, I noticed a few items by the statue, which must have been put there by the natives of this region. So we can take this stuff, but if we do, we'll lose standing. So I'm not going to. The voodoo doll allows us to slow down the other expeditions. It's a little bit underhanded. And we really can't afford the standing penalty. Alright, let's go see what this is. This could be a village. The desert villages are often in an area that's, are often completely surrounded by desert. So, do I want to eat some of my canned food? The food cans, the cans of beans, your crew will only eat them when they're low on sanity. So I'm thinking we might want to eat some now, and then so that we don't have to rest as many times at the village to get up to high. Yeah, I'm not desperate enough to eat this anymore. Alright, the natives effortlessly demanded respect as they were some form of religious unity. That's not quite... Anyway. Today we reached the camp of a nomadic tribe. A man in a British officer's uniform welcomed us to the village. Immediately I realized this was the deserter we had been asked to find. He introduced himself as Lieutenant Conrad. The village had a strangely oppressive undercurrent. You're coming with us, buddy. He assured us that he would not, in fact, be coming with us. Well, party you's coming with us. So here we just gotta fight this guy. He has 12 health and he has 3 dice. He's been upgraded. He's tougher than he used to be. So what do we want? We want to hold these. We're looking for that Ripper Leap again. I'm going to try to roll the bigger claws, so I'm not going to hold that die. And here, what we really want is we want to combine the face that looks like a little man with the shotgun to get a more powerful shotgun attack. So we got Ripper Leap, we've got high damage claws. So we only have to get 2 more damage on him, actually. Bam, now he'll bleed out at the beginning of his turn. Easy. Plus 10 sanity from fighting. Oh, we should have, I should have leveled the guy up before going into the village, because we knew there was a chance that we would encounter combat. Alright, and we got plus 2 standing. We have no choice but to kill Conrad. His military decoration would serve as proof of our actions. The villagers were thankful for his removal, and returned to their common routine. Fantastic. So, we can try to recruit somebody here. Now, we have a full party, but I think I'm willing to part with one of the sled dogs in exchange for a pack animal. And pack animals are all that we're being given access to. I like water buffalo a lot. Water buffalo have the best combat die of the common pack animals. I think riding a camel gives you bonus sanity reduction when you're crossing deserts. But I think we're going to take the water buffalo they're just generally good, even if they're not necessarily the best for what we're doing right now. Okay, so this is interesting. Obviously, we'd love the Tusk. Jewels are cool, but they have three jewels. We're not going to be able to afford all of the stuff we want from them, basically. And these mangoes are nice, too. Especially, we could use the mangoes to get to full sanity without lowering our standing. Or maybe just some of them. We don't really have that much to trade, though. We might actually have to come back to this village later. All we could really trade them is food cans, right? Well, we could trade 5 food cans for 5 mangoes. But we could eat all the mangoes right now and just leave with 3 standing. My concern is after we leave the village, we're probably not going to have high standing when we get back, because we're going to tend to want to, you know, steal stuff. So if anything we don't get now is effectively lost to us, is kind of how I feel about it. So why don't we take... Let's pay a torch and 2 food cans for the tusks. We'll sleep here once, which will take us to 1 standing. That'll take us to 73. And then we'll also get 2 mangoes from them so that we can go back to full. Okay. We unpacked our belongings and prepared to spend the night with the natives at their campfire. One of the villagers looked very concerned. She appeared to ask for my name. Fool that I am, I gave it to her. When she heard it, she grew more upset still. I could make out references to Roald Emmonson in her diatribe. She screamed that a man named Tupac visited some time ago and educated them about a villain with my name. He was quite successful at tarnishing my reputation, it appeared. How could that be? That was on a different continent. How'd he get over here? Well, we're going to study their culture. I listened to the stories of the elders and was able to document many of the customs and language of this foreign tribe. So we got this thing. It has low value, but it is worth a lot of fame. Alright, I got a splendid night's rest. So, that event talking about how Tupac had damaged my reputation didn't actually lower my standing. Interesting. Alright. Kifahu stayed behind for a while as he had more business to attend to with the villagers. However, he caught up with the trek not long after we had left. Alright, so we're going to eat our 2 mangoes right now. And let's move on. What is this? Oh, we can't move. We have too many trek members. Who's getting dismissed? Dory had that very good advice earlier. She's a smart dog. We're going to keep her. Dismiss or not dismiss Myra was such the dilemma. Not really that much of a dilemma. Good dog. Okay. Let's move on. I know it's sad to... It's sad to leave a dog with the villagers, but I think it's for the best. What is this? There's like a... Huh, that might be a new space texture. Alright, let's see. The building was cold to the touch. I wondered if the stone was resistant to warmth or just very good at staying cold. I don't know what the meaningful difference between those two things is. This is new, but obviously this is going to make the region more Arctic. Alright. Free stuff. All of a sudden, the temperature dropped all around me. I could see my own breath crystallize in the air, and every breath was like tiny needles were being jammed into my nose and throat. Alright, so the area is going to become cold very quickly after we leave. Well, I don't know where the pyramid is, but I mean, I expect it's over here somewhere. I guess we can just wander... Hey everybody, let's just wander into the desert blindly. I can't see how that plan could go wrong. Yeah, wow. So parts of the region are actually becoming impassable with the cold. That's interesting. This is all new stuff. It looks like it's going to keep expanding. We can see like snow. Maybe we should wait a second. Let's wait a day or two and see what it looks like. Okay, wow. It's actually like really blocking us in. This is not good. Is there a path? There is not. Crap, man. There's a solid wall of icy mountains preventing us from getting to the pyramid. Okay, we gotta, I guess, just head back? It seems the ice may have obliterated the village, too. This is not great. Yeah, I guess we just have to go back. That's new on me. Okay, we know for the future. Let's take these shrines, these cold shrines, very seriously. Oh, I should have eaten beans before playing the drums. Alright, we may as well go and take the stuff that was at the stone head now. Oh no, Kifahu was visibly shaken by the encounter with the odd statue and became superstitious. Crap. So that means that sometimes Kifahu will lose loyalty when we, like, disturb a stone head or burial grounds and stuff. I wanted to do this because these items are worth trade value at the very least. And we don't need to carry all this water anymore. Uh-oh, there's actually no way back to the ship! Oh, that's... I didn't realize... what can we do about this? Well, I think that the only option we have is to employ the escape balloon. That's pretty bad, though. I'm not pleased with that at all. Okay. Yeah, I don't think we really have a choice. We're stuck. We're completely trapped. So it's going to be more important to bring dynamite on your expeditions, it seems like, now. So that you can deal with these glacier areas. Alright, unfortunately, the balloon has limited space. So we only get to take two items with us, two items that consume space. So I'm going to take the shotgun and the tusks so that we have some funding for the next expedition. We're going to have to leave a lot of valuable stuff behind. We do get to bring this stuff with us because it doesn't take up any space. Yeah. That's a real bummer, man. We finished our preparations and boarded the balloon to begin our flight back home. So you don't get any normal points for mission completion when you use the balloon. Things could be going better. We triumphed, in a manner of speaking. Gun expert, this is a new trait, +2 damage when using a gun. So that could be very valuable to us. Promoting characters improves their loyalty. That's not very... promoting characters means leveling them up with exploration points. You don't do that very often, so this generally is pretty low value. And climber, reduced move cost from crossing hills. You don't cross hills very often, but the cost of doing so is significant, and it is something you probably will do like once or twice an expedition at least. So I don't think this is bad, but we do already have a gun, so let's just get better at using it. Yeah, so everybody else came home with lots of sweet treasures. And our score is going to look really bad. Sell this so that we have some funding. We didn't really have anything in the bank. Okay, well I think that's going to be it for this episode of Curious Expedition. Come back next time. We're going to the Forgotten Arctic. I don't even care if it's not the right expedition. It's brand new content and we want to see it. And we'll see you then.